In 1946, a man named Ishiro Honda walked through the streets of Hiroshima. Having served as an infantryman in World War II, he had experienced firsthand the atrocities of war, such as the occupation of Nanking, and later spending 6 months in a Chinese POW camp. However, nothing could compare to what he would see when returning home from the war. After defeating the Japanese, the Americans had the surrendered soldiers who were returning to Japan land in Hiroshima, so they could see how thoroughly defeated their homeland had been. But for Honda, he felt so much more than defeat. Seeing what the bombs had done to his country left him traumatized for the rest of his life, and he became a strong opponent of nuclear weapons. Honda reflected on this experience many years later by stating, "Back then, it was said that for the next 72 years, not a single blade of grass would grow there. And that really stayed with me. So I have a kind of hatred of nuclear weapons. It's horrifying to make such terrible weapons and use them on one city and then another." In the years that followed, Honda went back to his passion before the war, filmmaking. The next 8 years would see him work as a director and assistant director for people like Akira Kurosawa and Kajiro Yamamoto. But in 1954, he would direct a film that explored the trauma and pain caused by these atomic bombings, and introduce an iconic character to the silver screen at the same time. Now, let's jump ahead a few years. It's 2019, and I have just gotten out of seeing a new movie, Godzilla, King of the Monsters. It's the third installment in Warner Brothers and Legendary Pictures' Monsterverse, a shared cinematic universe with various movie monsters, such as Godzilla, King Kong, and... honestly, that's all they've got so far. I've known about Godzilla since I was 4 years old. I've seen almost every one of his movies, and I really liked the 2014 American reboot, which this was a sequel to. So to say that I was excited after waiting 5 years to see this movie is a huge understatement. But as I walked out of that theater, something felt wrong, and I wasn't sure what. It wasn't until I watched the film again with some friends a few weeks later that I realized what I didn't like about it, and it all had to do with this scene.
How many nukes do you have?
Why?
We could help him.
To set the context, Godzilla is dying at this point in the movie, and his nemesis, the three-headed dragon King Ghidorah, has taken his place as the Alpha Kaiju, or Titan as they call them in these movies, which will bring great destruction to the Earth. So, in order to bring Godzilla back, the human characters decide to use a nuclear warhead to revive him, or at least help speed up his healing process.
They want to bring Godzilla back from the dead.
They go deep into the hollow earth and detonate the nuke, which not only brings Godzilla back to life, but gives him the additional strength he needs to fight King Ghidorah. It seems like a pretty normal thing to do for this kind of movie, but when taking the history of Godzilla into account, and his origin as a symbol for the destructive power of nuclear weapons, this scene doesn't really seem right, and makes the whole movie feel disconnected from the original idea of the character. But how could this have happened? It's not like the filmmakers just decided to forget about the themes attached to the character and just do whatever they wanted. So, to figure this out, let's go back to the beginning and look at the history of Godzilla. The original Godzilla film, which for convenience's sake I'll be referring to as its Japanese title, Gojira, was released in 1954. At a surface level, the plot may seem familiar for a monster movie. After some fishing boats get destroyed for unknown reasons, a group of researchers try to figure out the cause. They travel to Oda Island, where they discover that the culprit is a giant sea monster named Godzilla. After learning more about him by studying his footprints, paleontologist Dr. Yamane determines that Godzilla was mutated by radiation from atomic bombs. Now that Godzilla is loose and is heading for Tokyo, the main characters must find a way to get rid of him once and for all. Produced by Tomoyuki Tanaka and directed by Ishiro Honda, the film contained many allegories for nuclear weapons. This was very common for movies of the time period. A new powerful weapon had been created, and the public was afraid of it. So to reflect these fears, many science fiction movies were made, specifically in America, that featured some sort of ancient monster or mutation attacking civilization due to the effects of nuclear weapons. One of these films was 1953's A Beast from 20,000 Fathoms, which it is worth noting was one of the inspirations for the creation of Gojira. The two films seem very similar when you first compare them, as they both involve a giant dinosaur-like creature that was awakened by nuclear bombs and wreaks havoc on the nearest city as payback. But what separates Godzilla from the Beast, and to some extent all of the American monster movies of the 50s, is the original film's historical context and impact. If it's not obvious yet, Gojira is very much a response to the bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. But these are not the only inspirations. Another source was the incident surrounding the Dago Fukuryu Maru, or Lucky Dragon 5, which happened earlier in 1954. A Japanese tuna fishing boat was caught in the blast radius of a 15 megaton H-bomb off the coast of Bikini Atoll, where America was carrying out tests. Nobody was made aware that these tests were happening, and as a result, the ship was contaminated, with several fishermen becoming sick from the radiation. Some eventually died. This caused a massive outcry from the Japanese public. The fear of radioactive tuna was spread, and several boycotts and anti-nuclear activist groups took place. Keeping this in mind, the opening scene of the film, in which Godzilla attacked a group of unsuspecting fishermen, would have been all too familiar for Japanese audiences. It is also worth noting that you do not even see Godzilla at this point, only a bright light and the destruction of the ships. And, of course, there are the bombings. In many American Atomic Age monster movies, the nuclear bomb was treated as a mysterious new force. The general public was not fully aware of their destructive power, so a lot of movies from the time period treated them like they were some sort of Pandora's box, since nobody really knew what they were.
When man entered the Atomic Age, he opened a door into a new world. What we'll eventually find in that new world, nobody can predict.
The only thing is, Japan knew. Japan is the only country to ever have experienced the devastating effects of the atomic bombs. Due to the American occupation after the war, heavy censorship forbade any explicit references to the bombings. But even after the Americans left, Japan did not really address the disasters at Hiroshima and Nagasaki. The people felt a sense of guilt and shame when talking about them. However, many films inspired by these incidents were eventually made over time, and even though it may not seem like a typical war drama, Gojira was one of them. In fact, Ishiro Honda even made the decision to have Godzilla's scales look like the scars of radiation burns, which makes his skin eerily resemble the wounds of many survivors from the atomic blasts. When Godzilla rampages through Tokyo in the film, the parallels are obvious. His destructive presence brings to mind not only Hiroshima and Nagasaki, but also the Tokyo firebombings. The aftermath is also harrowing. The panning shot of Tokyo decimated, and the scenes of the victims in the hospital afterwards are accompanied by a somber piece of music to emphasize just how many people have been affected by this monster's attack. Just like how many people were affected by the bombs. The conclusion of the film is powerful as well. Most American monster movies end on a positive note. The monster is defeated by the army, or sometimes even nuclear weapons. The protagonists wrap everything up, and the music swells as the end appears on screen. In Gojira, almost none of that is present. One of the conflicts in the movie revolves around a scientist named Dr. Sarazawa. He has created a device called the Oxygen Destroyer, which when placed in water, can remove the oxygen and kill any living thing in its vicinity. protagonists try to convince Sarazawa to unleash his weapon on Godzilla, since the military is no match for him. But Sarazawa is ashamed of his creation, and faces an extreme moral dilemma. Does he use it, and let the world become aware of the horrible new weapon he's created? Or does he not use it, and let Godzilla continue to cause more destruction? It isn't until he hears a children's choir singing a prayer for peace on the radio that he makes his decision. In the final scene of the movie, Sarazawa travels underwater to unleash the oxygen destroyer on Godzilla. It works, but Sarazawa chooses to commit suicide so that the secret of the weapon dies with him. At the same time, Godzilla's death is also treated with sadness. He's treated as a victim of the bomb as well. This is part of what makes the original Gojira such a powerful film. According to Honda, he and Tanaka made the decision that it was crucial for the film crew to know what they were doing. They all wanted the audience to understand how terrifying something like Godzilla would be in real life. The creators and crew all took the film seriously, and because of that, it resonated with Japanese audiences on an emotional level. It's not just a movie where a giant dinosaur shows up and starts attacking a city. It's an anti-war film. Honda was quoted years later saying, "Godzilla was born because of the atomic bombs." This is both literally and metaphorically true. In the film, he is mutated by the radiation from atomic testing, which causes him to go on a rampage. But on a deeper level, his existence as a whole is a direct response to the bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, and he is a grim reminder of how destructive these weapons can be, and the devastating effects they can have on humanity. The film ends with a speech from Dr. Yamane, not unlike other monster movies of the time, warning of the dangers of nuclear weapons. But unlike the American films, it carries more weight. The original Gojira was made in a nation that had experienced the powers of the nuclear age, and was directed by a man who saw these effects firsthand. Taking all this into consideration, the power of this film cannot be denied. So how did a symbol for the fear and anxieties of nuclear war get turned into a nuke-eating juggernaut for audiences to cheer on? I believe it has something to do with a movie called Godzilla, King of the Monsters. No, not that one. That one.
Godzilla, King of the Monsters, alive, surging up from the depths of the sea on a tidal wave of terror.
In 1956, the original Gojira was re-edited for American audiences. In 1950s America, the public was not fully aware of what had happened in Japan at the end of the war. All that was known was that they were the enemy, and so they had no sympathy for them. And, as mentioned before, they did not know to the full extent what would happen in an atomic blast. At that time, Hollywood started releasing more low-budget exploitative B-movies, and Godzilla was seen as having some appeal for American audiences. However, it would have been too foreign in its current state, and with the lack of knowledge about the bombings, people would have been too confused. Also, and this is important, they would not be able to understand a movie in Japanese. So, Godzilla, King of the Monsters, was released, but not without some major changes. Since it was assumed that the film would be more successful with audiences if a white actor was in it, the character of Steve Martin, played by Raymond Burr, was added as the new main protagonist. A reporter who is on his way to Cairo, Martin stops in Tokyo to meet an old friend of his, the original film's Dr. Sarazawa. It just so happens that Martin lands in Tokyo at the exact time that Godzilla is discovered. So the rest of the film plays out, but with Martin added into important scenes. This creates the false illusion that he is witnessing the events, even though it's a little obvious that they filmed these new scenes for the American release. Watch for any time one of the characters from the original film interacts with Martin. You'll only see the back of their heads.
Dr. Yamane.
Steve Martin, it is good to see you.
There were other important changes made to the American version as well. Besides the scene in the courtroom, all references to the bombs, Hiroshima, or Nagasaki were removed. Also, Dr. Yamane's speech at the end, the warning for a future of a world of nuclear testing, is gone, replaced by a generic ending monologue by Burr's character.
The menace was gone. So was a great man. but the whole world could wake up and live again.
In total, this new version runs 16 minutes shorter than the original, and as a result, feels disjointed. It seems to have more in common with the other American monster movies of the time than it does the original Gojira. All of the subtext is gone, and the references to nuclear bombs feel more like a plot device meant to get the monster on screen. But it looks like, in the end, all these changes made sense. This new version was extremely popular at the box office in America, and it even released again in Japan in 1957. What's important about this is that the success of the heavily altered American version allowed for Godzilla's popularity to explode. It would soon seem that Dr. Yamane's fear of another Godzilla appearing in the future would come true. For Godzilla would appear again, many more times. Over the decades, Godzilla evolved as a character. As the series continuously released new installments of the franchise in Japan, Godzilla's persona began to change. In the original Showa era, he went from being a somber allegory for nuclear destruction to a reptilian superhero, as writer William Tsutsui puts it, a Japanese Spider-Man. Godzilla became the good guy, and new evil monsters were introduced as opponents for him to defeat. But while the anti-nuclear message of the original might not have been as relevant as time went by, there were other themes that could be explored in these films. 1970's Godzilla vs. Ghidorah saw the King of the Monsters as a savior of the environment, fighting an evil pollution blob monster named Ghidorah. Known for its psychedelic imagery and blunt messages about saving the world, the film was released at a time when Japan's pollution rate was at an all-time high, so this film would have been extremely relevant. The Heisei era started in 1984, and saw Godzilla return to his darker origins, rebooting the series and ignoring all previous films except the original Gojira. Themes of environmentalism were still explored throughout these films, but the nuclear messages were also apparent. At the end of this set of films, in Godzilla vs. Destoroyah, Godzilla is shown experiencing a nuclear meltdown that, if not treated, will eradicate all of Japan and potentially the world. Thankfully, the humans manage to cool him down, but his death is still treated as a sad event, a reminder of how Godzilla was a victim of nuclear bombs too. The Millennium era also saw an update to what Godzilla stood for. In Godzilla, Mothra, and King Ghidorah, giant monsters all-out attack, the plot is centered around Japanese nationality. The original Godzilla is revived and possessed by the spirits of all the Japanese soldiers and victims of Japan from the Second World War, who are seeking vengeance for the crimes that were committed. As a result, this is the only time Godzilla can truly be considered evil, as he marches across the countryside, causing destruction and fighting any monster that gets in his way. While it could be argued that this film's intention is to see awesome monster fights on screen, there is something compelling about addressing the war crimes that Japan committed during World War II, and what happens when a country does not acknowledge its past atrocities. Throughout the decades, Godzilla has been used to interpret different themes and anxieties specific to the time period of each film, while his original purpose was still treated as an important issue. American audiences, however, did not see this. To them, Godzilla was just a big joke. The movies were poorly dubbed fluff where guys in rubber suits wrestle with each other, and were not taken very seriously as a result. Perhaps it is because of this, a pop culture osmosis, that what Godzilla stood for was not noticed or treated seriously by Americans. John Noriega, a professor of cinema at UCLA, explains that the different perceptions of Godzilla in America and Japan are due to the ways the two countries define the concepts of the other and the self. Noriega argues that Western thought defines the self in contrast to the separate and externalized other. Japan, on the other hand, maintains both by immersing the self in the other. In 1956's Godzilla, King of the Monsters, the other is overcome. The monster dies, and the horror of nuclear weapons is pushed away, along with any guilt Americans might feel for dropping the bombs. But in Gojira, Godzilla, who is a direct symbol of the atomic bomb, is effectively repeating the trauma of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, encouraging viewers to embrace the horror into their conscience and accept it as part of themselves. This could explain why Godzilla has remained such a popular character throughout the decades. The Japanese audiences relate to him through their own direct experience of the subject matter, whereas the detached American audiences only like seeing big monsters fight each other. And now we make it to 2019. We're setting off a nuke to help Godzilla, and Godzilla King of the Monsters is treated as a good thing.
How many nukes do you have?
It should not feel like a good thing. To be fair, the film does contain themes regarding climate change, so it doesn't feel too tone-deaf. But those themes do not feel sufficiently developed, and are sidelined to get the monsters on screen to throw down. So why does it feel weird for the new Godzilla King of the Monsters to not address the themes of the original film? I think it's because of two reasons. First, while it's true that Godzilla's message changed over time, those old films didn't disrespect the anti-nuclear messages. Godzilla was still known as a victim of the atomic bomb, and those ideas were still treated seriously. Even in Godzilla vs. Megalon, the film where this happens, nuclear testing is still shown in a negative light, and is the reason for the antagonists to declare war against humanity. Secondly, it just has to do with the fact that King of the Monsters is an American reboot. When remaking a foreign property, some of its original context is going to be lost in translation. It's inevitable, and with Godzilla, it's happened before. But the 2014 reboot, to its credit, did feel like it was trying to be more faithful to the original 1954 film. The tone is extremely dark, and it doesn't shy away from how disastrous something like a giant monster attack would be in real life. But most of the vocal detractors of that film only complained about one thing. Godzilla didn't get enough screen time. This was fixed in King of the Monsters, which focuses way more on the mindless monster action. When comparing the original Gojira to this new American film, so much of it feels weird. The oxygen destroyer makes a return, but here it only shows up for a few minutes with no previous introduction, and is used by the military to neutralize Godzilla. There is no clear moral conflict present with its creation, like in the original Gojira. It is simply reduced to a shallow reference for fans to pick up on.
We have been developing a prototype for a new weapon, an oxygen destroyer.
I know what that is!
There's also something deeply ironic about the scene where they bring Godzilla back. You see, the MonsterVerse has its own version of the character of Dr. Serizawa, who was introduced in the 2014 Godzilla film. And here, he is the one who decides to make the sacrifice by detonating the warhead. That's right, a character named Serizawa is once again sacrificing himself to deal with Godzilla. It's an emotional moment, sure, just like in Gojira. But in that film, he sacrificed himself as a way to prevent the secrets of the oxygen destroyer from being discovered, while also allowing Godzilla to be killed. It was a tragic and powerful moment that showed how both human and monster are victims of the nuclear age. In King of the Monsters, the context is different. Serizawa's sacrifice is now to save Godzilla, and give him the strength he needs from the bomb's power to fight back. By changing this plot point, Godzilla's message now feels reversed. Instead of opposing the use of nuclear weapons, this film appears to celebrate them by having them save the King of the Monsters. There's even the aftermath of Godzilla getting strong from the bomb. He still goes into meltdown mode just like he did at the end of the Heisei era, but it's not a tragic or serious issue. It's cool and awesome, intended to make audiences cheer.
Serizawa's got that lizard juiced!
This moment, and as a result the movie as a whole, rob Godzilla of his powerful anti-nuclear message that caused his creation in the first place. The bomb is no longer associated with Godzilla as a terrifying reminder of the past and a nation's fears. It has been turned into another plot device to get a big monster to fight another big monster on screen for the sake of audience spectacle. But hey, maybe I'm overthinking this. The bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki happened almost 76 years ago, and nuclear weapons aren't a huge concern in our modern world anymore. For now. And as it's been shown, there have been many different themes that have been explored in the Godzilla movies besides nuclear destruction. So maybe it's not so bad if this American film doesn't really address them in great detail. However, it still feels wrong to me. To see a film ignore and dismiss such an important message that's been a part of its history, an American film, no doubt, feels a little disrespectful. Sure, Godzilla may have evolved as a character over the last six decades, but that doesn't mean that what he stood for in 1954 isn't important. and it arguably is still relevant. 2016's Shin Godzilla, the first Japanese film in the franchise since 2004, returns the series to its dark roots by updating the concept of Godzilla for modern times, reflecting on the many more nuclear weapons that exist in the world today than when the first film came out. So it's clear that these films can still stand for something besides just being about monsters fighting. But unfortunately, that's all anyone seems to care about, at least in America. Go anywhere online, and you'll see fans raving about how Godzilla, King of the Monsters is a true Godzilla movie, one made with the fans in mind. But knowing what I know about this series, I can't really say I agree with that statement. As of this writing, the next installment in the Monsterverse, Godzilla vs. Kong, has yet to be released, but by the time this video essay is finished, it will have been. I can't really say if it'll be good or not, but I don't really expect the movie about Godzilla and King Kong fighting to have any deep, powerful statements about the world. And that's okay. It doesn't need to. I just hope it respects the themes of the original, or at the very least doesn't make the same mistakes that King of the Monsters did. Hopefully one day, more people will see Godzilla as a symbol for the death and destruction caused by nuclear warfare, just like when he first stomped across the screen all those years ago.